Well, for regular viewers of CNN and this show specifically, you will recognise a familiar face reporting from conflict zones in some of the most remote corners of the world alike. For the past 18 years, Arwa Damon has set the standard for courageous journalism with a heart. And today, sadly, is her last day as a CNN senior international correspondent. Arwa is best known for her compassionate storytelling, for treating her subjects with humanity and sensitivity in every television package and every digital piece. She's had a remarkable and, quite frankly, wild ride. She admits that herself. She started her career in 2003 at the Baghdad Bureau, reporting through some of the darkest days of the war in Iraq. In 2012, she was one of the first journalists to arrive in Benghazi, Libya, following the attack on the US embassy there. And she extensively covered the war against ISIS in Iraq and Syria, even getting trapped for 28 hours in Mosul after her team's convoy was ambushed and attacked by the terrorist group. But no matter where she went, the human side of the story remained a cornerstone of Arwa's reporting. And it was her personal experience in war zones that led her to launch a non-profit called Inara that provides medical care to children who need life-saving treatment. Well, in her goodbye note to the network, her colleagues, she wrote, and I quote, "I'm getting emotional now, so we'll end this by saying, it's a privilege to have a life where I have been able to have ideas and actually pursue them. This is another of those junctions in life, and it's time for me to see where that crazy path goes. It's unnerving, but I'm excited. And after all, if you know me, you know that I am more afraid of living with what if or if only than I am of taking a chance and failing." Well, Arwa joins me now for one last live hit. People thought you were crazy, Arwa, when you took up that job at CNN. You, though, did enjoy end up reporting through some of the darkest days of the Iraq war and others. Just reflect on some of what you've experienced with CNN, if you will.
I mean, first of all, Becky, I have to say I've been absolutely floored by the kind and generous and supportive response that I've gotten. And yes, you know, those years that I spent in Iraq formed who I am. They defined who I am. But it wasn't necessarily the moments of darkness that we experienced as a Baghdad bureau, whether it was the explosions or the killings or how deeply and profoundly, you know, what was happening in the streets of Iraq was impacting our friends, our CNN Baghdad family, our Iraqi staff. What really stands out for me when I look back on those years is this intense camaraderie that we had at the bureau, the way that we constantly supported each other. And there is one story in particular that just thinking about, talking about, gives me goosebumps, and that is, you know, the story of this little boy named Yusuf, who was 5 years old when CNN met him, and he had had gasoline dumped on his face. He was set on fire by unknown masked men. And the time that that happened, it wasn't just that people weren't paying attention to Iraq at the time. It was that this depression had really permeated Iraqis. Yeah. Permeated the bureau. And when we reported Yusuf's story for CNN, the response to that was just so overwhelming and resulted in Yusuf going to America and getting medical care and the joy of his parents. We adopted that joy. Their joy became our joy. Mm. And it bound us together in a way that's it's inextricable. Mm. We're bound together now. And it's beautiful.
It was your reporting, of course, that helped Yusuf eventually reach the US and get treatment. And you were able to go and visit him. And I just want our viewers to have a look back at this.
The outpour of support for Yusuf has truly been overwhelming, from viewers to NGOs to medical institutions, everybody wanting to help this 5-year-old child somehow. The family is utterly overjoyed, beside themselves, truly overwhelmed by all of those outside of Iraq that want to help their 5-year-old child.
I'm doing like soccer games and practice. I never used to do that in my country.
Mm-hmm. Why didn't you do it in your country?
Because it was kind of dangerous there.
Do you remember that day when those guys attacked you?
No.
Mm. Well, a decade on, that story is directly related to what you are doing now, which is focusing on your charity in Arwa. Just tell us about some of the work that charity has been able to achieve and what happens next.
Yeah, so basically, INADF is founded on my experiences through CNN and all of these various war zones where we'd come across all these children like Yusuf who weren't able to access the medical care that they need. And so I built up INADA, which now is providing not just medical treatment, but also simultaneously mental health treatment. And the thing that differentiates us, I think, from everybody else is we literally do take on the cases that others don't. Like, our whole premise is not to compete with other NGOs that are out there, but rather specifically look for the gaps that exist in access to medical care and figure out how we can build and fulfill those gaps. And right now we've been able to help more than 500 children. We put them through surgeries. We put them through intensive mental health treatment. We have around 200 on our waiting list. And yeah, there's a lot of work to be done in that arena. And, you know, Becky, a lot of the response I've been getting to me leaving has also been sort of concern being expressed that I'm leaving journalism behind. And I just want to reassure everybody that I am definitely not done storytelling. There's a lot of ideas bouncing around this little head. And, you know, I do hope to keep pursuing storytelling in a very intense and invigorating way and figuring out new and different ways to help people, but also help connect people. I think that's really what I would want to strive to be doing right now, whether it's through INADA or through a form of storytelling, is really kind of reminding people of the ways that we're connected.